This COVID-19 podcast, produced by the George Washington University Hospital, was recorded on April 14th, 2020. Welcome to GW Hospital Healthcast. I'm Oscar Ceballos, and today's guest is Dr. Farzad Najam, Chief of Cardiac Surgery, and Dr. Elizabeth Pocock, Cardiac Surgeon at GW Hospital. Today, we'll be exploring ECMO technology and its use for treating critically ill COVID-19 patients at the George Washington University Hospital in Washington, D.C. As we know, COVID-19 often attacks the lungs. It can also affect other organs in the body, including the heart. Once the lungs and the heart fail, places like GW Hospital are using a highly specialized technology called ECMO to do the work of the heart and lungs in those critically ill COVID patients. So what is ECMO? How does it work? Why is it important for COVID-19? Dr. Najam and Dr. Pocock are here to answer our questions. Dr. Najam, can you first tell us how does COVID-19 attack the body, and in particular, the lungs and heart?
I'm not an infectious disease specialist, but what I've learned is that like other viral illnesses, the virus infects body's cells, and that leads to a instigation or initiation of inflammatory response. The body reacts to any foreign insult or trauma by starting an inflammatory response. That inflammatory response is mediated through some chemicals. Those chemicals are called the inflammatory mediators. What we have we're seeing is that the response of the body with these viral illnesses in COVID-19 is very heightened. That response is called a cytokine storm, where those small chemicals, which are called the cytokines, or the interleukins, those are chemicals which are the defense chain or mechanism of the body to fend off infection. That gets really multiplied, and if it goes unabated, that can lead to a multi-organ failure, lung damage, heart damage, and eventually death.
Dr. Pocock, how do you describe COVID's effect on the body?
And I think all these things are sort of only just being studied, and really the learning on it is just at the very infancy. But what I can say is what most people recognize COVID as is really a bad pneumonia. The lungs are tremendously affected, causing the cough and all these things. Other things that you see with COVID are the fever and the muscle aches and things like that. And that is really your body's response to the virus. One of the things that we can see, which is actually pretty grave, is if you start to have the virus attacking the heart or infiltrating the heart, which most people would call myocarditis. So myocarditis is not necessarily a specific term. It just means inflammation of the heart. But when we see that with COVID, it's certainly very, very significant. And it's a sign of being very, very ill.
What is ECMO and how does it work?
ECMO, Oscar, stands for Extracorporeal Membrane Oxygenation / Extracorporeal Life Support. Extracorporeal life support is simpler to understand because this is a means of a procedure which can support life with machines and oxygenator. We circulate blood from the patient's body into a machine which pumps blood through an oxygenator. An oxygenator is another machine where the blood flows through these membranes where the blood has oxygen put in and carbon dioxide removed, and then that blood is put back into the patient's body.
The way I would describe ECMO is it is a form of the heart-lung machine that we use during heart surgery, meaning when we're doing heart surgery, we have a machine that does the work of someone's heart and their lungs so that we can do the operation. So what ECMO is a way that we can take that out of the operating room and do that same technology for patients who are critically ill, meaning use the machine to give their heart and lungs time to recover.
It can do the job of the lungs, and it can also do the job of the heart outside the body.
It does the work of both. Depending on what's injured, there's different ways that we can configure it, but it does do the work of the lungs. So it takes the blood from the body, puts oxygen in it, takes out the toxins, which for most purposes is considered carbon dioxide, and then returns the blood. So you're essentially doing the work of the lungs while you're just trying to give the lungs time to recover. For the heart, when the heart's injured, the heart is not squeezing as strongly as it should, meaning the heart's job is to move the blood around the entire body. And so when the heart's injured, it can't do that. So another component of ECMO is it can function as a pump. So function to move the blood around the body while the heart is injured and is recovering.
Who are the ideal candidates for ECMO whose lungs and or heart are failing them?
I would say that it's not that I can pick an ideal candidate and help that patient completely. You know, what we do is we look at relative contraindications. Of course, resources are not that many. We have finite resources and we have to be very careful in how do we use resources. But philosophically also, you know, that we have a finite number of resources, but each one life is as important as the 20 million other lives. So we focus on that. Then we go backward that in terms of what is their age, what is their comorbidity, what are the contraindications of doing ECMO, what is the chance of recovery in a person who's going to go through ECMO. Philosophically, I would say it's not that we don't want to do ECMO, but you have to understand ECMO is an invasive procedure. So we as physicians have to also balance out, do no harm. So if the balance is that if we are going to cause more harm on an 85-year-old person who is COVID positive, has multi-organ failure, that their chances of recovery are very little. And there is more chance of causing harm on a person who's 85 years old versus the benefit. Now let's flip the coin. If there's a 60-year-old person who's got a single organ which is not working, which is the lungs, then I think, you know, you're very hopeful that if you can sustain life through, because without ECMO, let's say we reach that point where the ventilators are not helping this person, then we can escalate the care to ECMO to sustain life, allow body to heal. And then, you know, those are the perfect patients that we have one lung function, which is one organ, which is not working, or catching those patients who before they go into multi-organ failure. So these are the ideal patients where we want to escalate the care. What I'm not saying is that ECMO is a replacement for ventilators. I mean, we are in a, the supply of ventilators is so scarce. The supply of ECMO controllers and platforms even more scarce. So you have to be very careful, and ECMO is very resource intensive. There are specialized units, specialized hospitals, specialized nurses, specialized ECMO specialists, there's specialized physicians who know day in and day out how to deal with ECMO. And plus, data has shown that the survival of patients who go on extracorporeal circulation like ECMO is better in high volume centers because, you know, of the experience. There are so many nuances about ECMO and 100 and 200 variables that everybody has to look at. So it's a very much a resource-driven modality, but it's very resource-intensive modality. So of course you want to be very careful, but you know, it can sustain life and escalate to a level where you cannot sustain these patients on a regular ventilator. But by no means it's a substitute for the ventilators. It's a complement to the care of a person who's level of deterioration is to a point where they cannot be kept alive without escalating it to ECMO.
And has there been anything that actually has surprised you from the experience you've had with COVID-19? While I know it's been limited, what have you seen?
What surprised me the most with our right now limited experience with COVID-19 patients who've gone on ECMO is how intense this inflammatory response is, how virulent, how fatal the infection can be. And this is where it got real for me, having dealt with many patients in the past who've had other forms of viral illnesses, ARDS, lung infections, heart infections, myocarditis. What really got real for me is that how much inflammatory response this virus can cause.
What I would say is, what I always try and remind people is that I only see just the, you know, the sickest of the sick patients who have COVID. So I can't really speak to the vast majority of patients, which either feel fine or feel, you know, maybe a little bit unwell, but they're still at home. And again, that's, you know, probably close to 50% are in that category. The ones that I see are probably the only the 5%. So maybe 20% of people get hospitalized for COVID. And I really only see or hear or am contacted about the most critically ill, which is about 5% of the population for COVID. So what I always tell people is that we have been taking care of critically ill patients here at GW for forever. We've been doing ECMO for about 12 years. So we are very, very used to taking care of critically ill patients who require ECMO. This is what we do all day, every day. So what I can say from my practice, what I noticed specifically that is different about the COVID patients are they come in and they have this catastrophic pneumonia for which we will place them on ECMO, which again is just a tool to give time to allow their lungs to recover. And so what we find is that the time is really significant. The time that they're going to remain critically ill is weeks. And so that is unusual. A lot of the patients that we have who require ECMO are actually one of our goals is to wake them up and get them up walking around even on ECMO. And that is certainly not even a remote possibility with the COVID patients requiring ECMO. So the duration, the severity of it is very significant. And then what we've talked about a little bit before is just that even after a few weeks when you're starting to hope that you're going to see them improving and turning the corner, at that point, what we see is some folks will start to develop changes of their heart, which is a sign that the virus is infiltrating their heart, which is generally a very severe, a very high mortality problem to have.
What is the team effort that is needed to treat a COVID-19 patient?
Taking care of ECMO patients requires a team effort, which spans across physicians from multiple disciplines, multiple specialties. In our institution, we work very closely in the division of cardiac surgery. We work very closely with the division of critical care. Critical care is where the patients are housed. We have physicians who are intensivists, and we have physicians who are cardiac surgeons. Then we have nursing staff. We have ECMO specialists. We have ECMO nurses. We have ECMO coordinators. We have ECMO-trained nurse practitioners. We have ECMO-trained physician assistants. We have ECMO-trained physiotherapists. We have ECMO-trained respiratory therapists. So all of them come together to take care of one particular patient who goes on ECMO. Now, in case those patients who are on ECMO need other specialties to help out, like infectious diseases, renal nephrology, neurology, those, we have access to all of those specialties in case we need their help.
I think one of the nice things that has come out of this, if there is a nice thing, is really the collaboration. The collaboration between different specialties within the hospital, the collaboration with different fields completely outside of medicine, like virtual reality. Dr. Mortman was able to take one of our first patients and convert his CT scan with virtual reality so that we could really see much more eloquently where the damage is in the lung from the COVID. Now, what we've talked about is there a way to use this technology? Can we harness it to do a difference in how it's diagnosed? Or is there a way that we can use that CT imaging to guide the treatment? Could we do something different, say, as far as the positioning of the patient that we see based on that virtual reality platform to improve their care? And I think that's what we're seeing really across the board. You're just seeing tremendous brainstorming from people, all specialties, you know, really trying to be thoughtful and come up with different ways to treat this pandemic. Are there different medications that people haven't thought of to use? Is there artificial intelligence that we can use? All the different ways that people are coming together and working together to try and solve this has really been remarkable.
What is your parting advice to keep us safe during this COVID-19 pandemic?
What I would say is that the simple things which we are doing ourselves and talking to our friends and family and colleagues is that social distancing or social isolation so that we can mitigate and we can flatten the curve. We can stay away for the time being. We can stop the contagion. And once the contagion is stopped, we will be able to go back to our lives. There's a lot of hope. We will get through this. But for now, I think we can just stop the contagion and change the course of this disease.
If you or someone you know is experiencing COVID-19 symptoms, please call your primary care physician or urgent care for an assessment. Please visit gwhospital.com/coronavirus for more information and the latest updates. Please note, physicians are independent practitioners who are not employees or agents of the George Washington University Hospital and shall not be liable for actions or treatments provided by physicians. For language assistance, disability accommodations, and the non-discrimination notice, visit gwhospital.com.